Good morning, everyone. And obviously, I'm not Pastor Lisa. Pastor Lisa had every intention of being here this morning. In fact, she was intending to be home on Friday. And it seems that her flight was canceled. And I got a call at 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon, and our council president, Ellen Storz, mentioned that her flight had been canceled, and she was scheduled to be out of there by 7 o'clock last night, but we weren't sure. So I went on red alert. I was on standby, and Ellen called me an hour or so later and said, you know, things are uncertain. Could you be willing to take it tomorrow? I said, sure, I'd be glad to. But Lisa is home. She got home about 1 o'clock this morning. So we're glad to hear that. So at any rate, here I am and here you are, and welcome. It's good to have you here, and it's good to have you folks at home here as well. I would like to call your attention to those announcements that appear on your bulletin and in the news notes. And of course, a reminder that this morning, being the first Sunday of the month, we are sharing at the Lord's table. And, you know, the little communion cup and set that you get, I've got to say, this is the cutest one I've seen. I've seen several of these, but I really like this one. This is neat. So when it comes time for communion, you tear the one end off and get the little bread cube in there, and then you take the other end off for the grape juice. And you folks at home, get whatever elements you would like and be prepared to share with us as well. Would also like to mention that following children's time, I don't know if we've got any young people this morning, we'll find out. At any rate, we will be having Sunday school immediately following children's time, and they will be going to their classes. Well, at this time, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship.
Stand and join with me in our call to worship. Isaiah with a vision and a call, and responded,
"Here I am, send me."
Paul was surprised by the Spirit with an interruption and a challenge and responded,
"I received from the Lord the word of grace I now proclaim."
Weary fisher folk were surprised by Jesus at their empty boats with a sign and a promise and responded,
"They left everything to follow."
Let us worship the God whose call surprises and challenges us all. Let us pray together in unison the prayer in the bulletin.
Holy One, you are ready to meet us wherever we are in our lives, offering vision, interruption, and hope where we may be least expected. Surprise us here at worship today with some grace unexpected that will change something in us, large or small, and send us into the world inspired and compassion to do your work. In Jesus' name, we gather and pray. Amen.
Ourselves off from their need.
Lord, have mercy.
You call us through the cries of those who struggle to change structures of oppression, but we turn away from their challenge.
Christ, have mercy.
You hint, you invite, you surround us with calls to love. You more fully and follow you more faithfully, but we cling to comfort and safety.
Lord, have mercy.
Hearken now to the comforting assurance that wherever we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Know that your sins are forgiven. Amen. And now, let us safely pass the peace with one another. You can do it with a wave or thumbs up or whatever the case might be. Do we have any young people with us this morning?
I am.
Oh, okay. Well, you're all young at heart. and so you're going to get it in there. And this morning, I'm going to put you to work. I'm going to have you sing. Now, it's a melody you're familiar with, but I'll sing it through the first time, and then we'll go from there. Amen. When something happens in church, like the good music we just had earlier, instead of clapping, we say, Amen. Right. At the end of the sermon, the pastor quite frequently says, Amen. And all of you folks out there in the congregation are saying, Amen, brother, I thought that sermon would never end. Okay, we say it different ways, though, don't we? Some people say, Amen. Other people say, Amen. If we go back to the original language in the Bible languages, the Old Testament Hebrew, the New Testament Greek, those people said, Amen. Try it, say it. Amen. Very good. Now, if anybody asks you, can you speak Greek? You can say, a little bit. Be honest about it. Okay, it doesn't make any difference how we say it or pronounce it, does it?
Nope.
It all means the same thing. Wait a minute. What does it mean, really? It doesn't mean the end. Well, if we go back to the original root meaning, it means let it be. It's really like a little prayer at the end of our prayers. It's a way in which we're saying, God, if it is your will, let this happen. At the end of our prayers, we're saying, this is how I feel. This is what I desire. God, if it is your will, let it be. Amen. And so from now on, whenever we use that word, sharp though it might be, we realize it's really saying to God, your wisdom is greater than my wisdom. If it is your will, so let it be. Let's bow for a brief word of prayer. Oh God, we speak with you on many occasions. We express our needs, our desires, our hopes, our dreams, and our thankfulness. Whenever we express those needs, whenever we express our ultimate desires, be with us. Decipher what we truly do need, and if it be your will, let it be. Amen. Thank you, young people. Thank you.
prepare for the reading of Holy Scripture. I ask that you join in me with the unison prayer of preparation. God, whose word calls us to take risks, appear to us as we listen to the Scriptures and lift our eyes to see your face. Grant that we may feel your presence and discern your will. Equip us to respond with confident faithfulness to your call. Open your peoples to live together as you intend. Amen. Our first scripture lesson today is a well-known passage. It's the call of Isaiah, also the vision of God in the temple. It's so well known and often read that it's marked right here in the Bible. I have a little star and pencil, so you can't miss that it's important. This is from Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings, and with two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." Here ends the reading from the Hebrew Scripture. May God add blessings to this reading and the hearing of God's holy word. Please say, "Thanks be to God."
Thank you, Mark, and thank you, Ruth and Amy, for that very, very beautiful music. Our gospel lesson this morning comes to us from the 5th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. We read starting at the first verse, and we find here Luke's account of Jesus calling his first disciples. Now, while the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had ceased speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a great shoal of fish. And as their nets were breaking, they beckoned to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. Henceforth you will be catching people." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. Amen. Please pray with me. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Wouldn't it be great if everything in our lives fell neatly into place? We try to cause that to happen, don't we? We make our plans. We shape our future. We look not just weeks or months, but years ahead. And we say to ourselves, this is precisely what I would like to happen. And we work for it. We seek those goals. We honestly do. And then we get caught up in the routine, the mundane activities of everyday living. And it's tough, but we learn to live with it. And still we're able to plod along and work toward those goals that we hold to be so important. And then come all those unexpected things. More tasks that are thrown in our direction. Illness that hits us or the people we love. Repairs that have to be made, and they cause money. And they cause financial concerns. Things that come out of the blue over which we have no control, like a pandemic, or yes, like a snowstorm. And we find that all of life really becomes muddled. A jumble, cluttered. Our lives become as cluttered as our closets or our desk drawers. And we look at it all and we find ourselves saying, isn't this a fine kettle of fish? It's a mess. I just wish it would all go away, or at least I can get away from it for a time anyway. Well, before we fall into the trap of blaming it all on our rapid paced world or modern technology, let's take a look at the disciples and what was happening in their lives. You see, they had all of those jumbled messes as well. They had a routine. Their routine involved sorting the fish, the big ones from the little ones, the edible ones from those that were worth nothing more than to be used for fertilizer. They had to mend the nets. They had to patch their boats. And then they had all of those things, again, over which they had no control. Perhaps they would have those stretches where they couldn't get any fish in their nets. And then there was always the worry of what's going to be the price in the market for what we bring in. And yes, they had to confront illness as well. And weather would often force itself upon them. There were storms out on those lakes. Being a fisherman in that day and age, it was a dangerous business. They had a real kettle of fish. And I'm sure there were times when they felt like they wanted to get away from it as well. Well, on this occasion, they came in after another night of no luck whatever. And so they were going about the routine of getting things cleaned up, stashed away, and Jesus of Nazareth stepped into one of the boats. It happened to be Simon Peter's. And he said, "Simon, put out a bit from shore so I can teach the people from there." So Simon rowed out, and Jesus got in the front of the boat and began to teach. Now, a little bit of side information here. You've often heard in some occasions the bow of the boat being called the pulpit. Now you know why. Here's Jesus preaching from the front of the boat, using it as a pulpit. And when he finished teaching, he had the audacity to try to give these professional fishermen a fishing lesson. "Simon, row out into the deep. Let down your nets." Simon said, "Oh, Lord, we fished all night. There's nothing out there. We tried, but nevertheless, at your word, we'll do it. Lo and behold, the nets were so full they couldn't handle it. They had to call to their partners in the other boat. And between the two boats, they filled them up and the boats were about to sink. And Simon Peter was so overwhelmed, he fell down on his knees and said, 'Oh Lord, depart from me, for I am a sinful man.'" What a miraculous event. Nothing happening at all, except bad routine and no luck. And then an overwhelming catch of fish. End of story, right? No. No, what we have here is the beginning of it all. Because Jesus said, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Wow. Isn't that something? Here was maybe what they'd always dreamed of. The opportunity to leave all that behind them. The nets, the boats, the smelly fish, and to go on some new venture they had never before dreamed of. Kind of like we'd all wish to experience, isn't it? Someone saying, "Come, follow me, leave all this behind." There's only one problem. When we leave one set of things behind us to move on to something else, there is a new set of responsibilities. And it wasn't long before the disciples found that out. Sure, at first it was exciting. It was something new, walking from town to town. All these people, my goodness. But then after a while, they began to realize there was a sameness about all of it. Things weren't happening quite as fast as they thought they should be happening. And I'm sure they reached that point where they went to Jesus and said, "Teacher, things just aren't happening like we thought they would. The people, yeah, they, for the most part, they're coming. They gather around. But so many of them, they come, they listen, and they walk away, and we never see them again. Other people, they walk by on the edge, and they look, but then they keep going. And a lot of people that do come, oh, Master, the only reason they come is they need something. They want something. They want to be healed because they're sick. They want you to help straighten out their lives because they're either depressed or they've had a bad relationship with somebody and they expect you to take care of it. Or they want to be fed. This is hard work. It's hard work, and we don't know if we're up to it. To which Jesus probably said, sure. Of course it's hard work. Doing God's work is always a difficult task. Up until now, you've been sorting fish. Now you have to sort people. And what that means is you need to be able to understand what is happening in those people's lives. You need to deal with what they're saying and the needs they're feeling with all manner of sensitivity. And then you need to be willing to reach out to them and meet those needs. Yes. God's work is hard. It's difficult. It's never easy. Well, we have those times when we'd like to move on, and sometimes we even feel as if we've had that opportunity. Can you remember what it was like at the end of a semester? Oh, wasn't that great? The tests were over. The papers were done. What a relief. Or at work, the project that we've been working on for months, finally, it's completed. We met the deadline. But lo and behold, there's always another semester. The classes begin again. And yes, another project that happens at work, and another deadline to be met. It never seems to end. Life, regardless of where we are, it's filled with hard, difficult work. Even when we're faithful, devoted Christian people, we sometimes feel our faith should make all of that a lot easier. But it never does it? And sometimes it makes our lives even more difficult. It means we have to approach each and every set of circumstances with an awareness that we are being called somehow to do things in a manner that God wants us to do them. And that is never easy. Are we up to it? Are we capable of all of that? Well, once again, look at the disciples. They were a pretty fine kettle of fish themselves. In many respects, they were inept. They were ill-prepared. At times, they were rather picky. They had jealousy in their ranks from time to time. They weren't quite sure what to do to accomplish this realm about which Jesus was speaking. And yet, over time, Jesus was able to shape them. Just as Christ is able to shape all of his people, even the likes of you and me. And that's not an easy process for those of us being shaped. There was a piece of marble tile that formed a portion of a floor in a museum. And each and every day, the people would walk over that piece of tile. And one day after the museum had closed, the lights were dim, it looked up at a piece of fine sculpture. And the piece of tile on the floor said, "I don't get it. I just don't get it." The piece of sculpture said, "What don't you get?" And the piece of tile said, "We came from the same quarry. We were mined on the same day. And after a time, the sculptor threw me on a pile and then continued to work on you. I don't get it. And the fine piece of sculpture said, because you refuse to be shaped. The sculptor could not shape you, and he tossed you aside. You see, whenever you are being shaped into something new, it's painful, it hurts. But then that is the price of becoming something new. Peter, Andrew, John, and James, they were among the first called to be Jesus' disciples. They went through a tough period of training. They left everything behind, only to discover a new set of responsibilities. But Jesus shaped them. It was painful, yes, but they were shaped. Shaped in the same manner that God shapes us as well. And yes, there are times when that is painful. Yet, we do allow ourselves to be shaped. Because after all, we are the church. Amen.
Thank you.
God who calls us to participate in your vision of justice for our world. Let our offerings become our response. All your people fed, all your people safe, all your people housed, all your people educated. Amen.
Please bow in prayer. O God, our lives at times seem so jumbled. They are filled with so much that goes on around us. May we recognize that we are your people, and in the midst of that turmoil, we are given strength and hope. Guide us each and every day that we live. Guide us each and every day that we walk into your world. We see those who are in need. Give us the patience to stop and to reach out to them. We look around and we realize those many things that are wrong in our world. Fill us with the willingness and the desire to try to make things straight and good and right. Be with us as we worship. Be with those of our number who were unable to be here this morning. May we recognize that we are called to be members one of another. Be especially with those of our number who are sorrowing, those who are ill, those who struggle. Be with Shirley, Dwayne and Donna, Lydia, Vernon, John, and AJ. May they recognize that we are with them in our love, and that you are with them at all times, granting your grace and your healing. For this we ask in the name of your Son and our Savior. Amen. And now may our beginning be in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, our blessed Savior, Jesus Christ, instituted the communion of his body and blood, that it might be the abiding memorial of his atoning death, the seal of his perpetual presence in the Church of the Holy Spirit, the mystical representation of the sacrifice of himself upon the cross, the pledge of his undying love for his people, and the bond of his living union and fellowship with them to the end of time. The Lord's Supper has always been regarded by the Church as the innermost sanctuary of Christian worship. We have to do here not with signs merely, but with the reality which these signs represent. The Lord's table can therefore be rightly approached only by those who are of a devout, repentant, and believing mind. But to all such, Jesus himself says, "Come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You therefore who have searched your own hearts and minds, approach with me now to his throne of grace, and let us join in the sacrament of communion." Let us join in our responsive prayer of invitation. May God be with us all.
We lift our hearts up to God and give thanks and praise to God.
It is right and meet, beautiful and holy, that we should, in ceaseless joy, give our thanks and praise to you, holy and merciful God. And so, in grateful procession of endless praise, with the Church that is and was, that shall be forever, we glorify you, God of our ancestors and our God.
Amen.
me in our responsive Eucharistic prayer. Holy are you, eternal one.
You sit above, through, and within the circle of the earth.
Setting light into being, casting the stars in the sky, founding the evolving earth and all that dwell within it.
Limitless is your power, and great is your wisdom.
You look upon the lowly as your most cherished creatures.
You visit the downtrodden with presence, grace, and promise of eternal justice.
You sent to us your own child, Jesus, who searched into the unexpected, reached into the unexpected places.
Calling women in our lives of their lives, equipping men for nurturing well, and welcoming children into your holy embrace.
Let us listen attentively to the words of our Lord. As on the night in which he is betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my body, broken for you." In like manner, he took the cup when they had eaten. And after giving thanks, he blessed it. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins." O God, we ask for your blessing upon these elements of bread and wine. They represent the sacrifice made by your Son and our Savior. May we find ourselves cleansed with newness of life because we have shared at this meal. And hear us as we use those words your Son himself taught us to use when prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now join together in sharing at this meal. This is the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, broken for you and for many. Take and eat of it. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink of it, in remembrance of it. Take and drink. Let us join in our prayer of thanksgiving. We have been fed, Holy One, by your presence. We have been led, Eternal One, by your presence. Make the death and your glory now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace, now and always. Amen.